Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. We're so delighted that you guys have joined us this evening. I'm Pastor Joel Bohannon. This is Practical Godliness Live. We are so excited to be back with you guys. We just want to start with a word of prayer as we dive right into tonight's topic. Let's pray together. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you for your Holy Spirit, for your leading and your guiding. We thank you for your mentorship, for being a friend, for being close, for leading, for everything that you've done. We ask in Jesus' name tonight, as we open your word, that your Spirit would move in our midst. Let your will be done, we pray, in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. We're back. Amen. We're back. Our topic for tonight, I've entitled this study, Through the Fire. Through the Fire. And I want to answer the question tonight, who should I be listening to? Who should I be listening to? Now, this is in regards to religion, in regards to Christianity, in regards to guidance, in regards to mentorship in the faith, growing in the faith. You know, there is a church literally on every corner. There is a house of worship, not all Christian. You have all different types of religious organizations. Some believe in Christ, some believe in Buddha, some believe in XYZ, Allah. But tonight, we're dealing specifically with Christianity, amen. And I want to talk specifically coming from the book of 1 Corinthians. Now, if you have your Bibles, you can turn there. And 1 Corinthians chapter 3 shares with us a controversy that's going on in the Corinth church. They are basically having a debate on who is the greater apostle. It's a debate between Apollos, Paul, and Peter. Listen to what the Bible says. If you go to chapter 3, the Bible says, and I'm reading now from the New Living Translation, "Dear brothers and sisters, when I was with you, I couldn't talk to you as I would to spiritual people. I had to talk as though you belonged to this world or as though you were babies in Christ. I had to feed you with milk, not with solid food." Now, I know that we have taken a hiatus over the last month, XYZ, or two, but the book of Hebrews, this is another scripture just for thought. Hebrews chapter 5 tells us what the milk of the word is. Hebrews, let's just read that briefly, because I want your faith to be based on what the scriptures say and not just based on what the preacher says. Listen to what the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 13. Let's go to verse 12. "Although by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the basic principles of God's revelation. Again, you need milk, not solid food. Now, everyone who lives on milk," this is verse 13, "is inexperienced with the message about righteousness because he is an infant. But solid food is for the mature, for those whose senses have been trained to distinguish between good and evil." So Paul is telling the church at Corinth that he had to feed them with milk and not with solid food because they weren't ready for anything stronger. In other words, he's saying they should have been teachers, but after he had communicated with them, the issue that's going on in the church lets him know that they are still in the infancy of their Christian experience. And he says, I can't even feed you with whole food. We've got to review what the basic principles, the elementary principles of the gospel are. And he tells us in Hebrews chapter 6 what these principles are. And the Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 1. And we just appreciate Elder Thomas. We're making him work here. Praise God. Hebrews chapter 6 and verses 1 through 3. It says, therefore, let us leave the elementary teachings about Christ and go on to maturity, not laying again a foundation of repentance from dead works, faith in God, teaching about ritual washings or baptism, laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. And we will do this if God permits. So these are this is the milk. And so the controversy that the Corinthians are having is who's the greater apostle? Who's the better preacher? that's the controversy they're having. Who is the better preacher? And that's amazing that how the issues that they were having in 100 AD, around roughly, these issues that they're having in the Corinthian church are really similar to some of the issues that we're having today. Who's the better preacher? I remember growing up in the faith, coming out of the seminary, and we used to have what we would call preach outs. And that's where you get 5 to 6 or 7 preachers, and we'd all get 15 minutes, and we'd all have our 15 minutes to shine. And it was really a competition to see who was the better preacher. And I had just learned how to preach, but what I noticed was they either had me always going first or always going last, and I couldn't understand why. And now they always have me going last. I still don't know why, but we're just going to say that the topic for today is who's the better preacher? Help me, Holy Ghost. I learned something standing up in front of people preaching after other preachers had preached. I learned that each one of us were unique in our presenting of the message that God gave us. Each one of us had strengths. Each one of us had perspectives, and we each were used by God in a special, special way. So it's not really a competition as long as Christ is winning. But the Bible says here in verse 2, I had to feed you with milk, not with solid food, because you weren't ready for anything stronger, and you still aren't ready. For you are still controlled by your sinful nature. You are jealous of one another and quarrel with each other. Doesn't that prove you are controlled by your sinful nature? Are you willing? Aren't you living like people of the world when one of you says, I am a follower of Paul, and the other says, I follow Apollos? Aren't you acting like the people of the world? After all, who is Apollos? Who is Paul? We are only servants through whom you believe the good news. In other words, they both were preachers, and they both preached the good news of Jesus Christ. And the church is basically saying, because we part of the church is saying, well, we heard the gospel from Paul. And another part of the church is saying, we heard the gospel from Apollos. And they are basically saying, I'm better than you because I heard the gospel from Paul. And the other group is saying, well, we're better than you because we heard the gospel from Apollos. And the Bible tells us, when one of you says, in verse 4 of 1 Corinthians chapter 3, I'm a follower of Paul, and another says, I follow Apollos, aren't you acting just like the people of the world? After all, who is Apollos? Who is Paul? We are only God's servants through whom you believe the good news. So Paul gives them a reality check. He tells them, we're just servants that God sent so that you could believe the good news. Each of us did the work the Lord gave us. Verse 6, I planted the seed in your heart and Apollos watered it, but it was God who made it grow. It's not important who does the planting or who does the watering. He says it doesn't matter which one of us planted. It doesn't matter which one of us watered. It was God who made you grow. It doesn't matter if the preacher that preached the gospel to you the first time was great and the preacher who preached you information about the gospel was even better. We're just servants sent by God to help you to believe. The Bible says in verse 7, it's not important who does the planting or who does the watering. What's important is that God makes the seed grow. The one who plants and the one who waters works together with the same purpose, and both will be rewarded for their own hard work. For we are both workers, and you are God's field, you are God's building. So Paul is telling the people at Corinth to stop confusing who, to stop elevating the servant literally above the master. He's literally telling them, look, Paul, I planted a seed. Apollos, yes, Apollos watered the seed, or I watered the seed and Apollos planted the seed. It does not matter. We're just literal servants of the Most High God sent to help you to grow. And God is the one that's causing you to grow. Listen to what the Bible says in verse 10. In the final portion of verse 9, he says, you are God's building. Verse 10, because of God's grace to me, he says, I have laid the foundation like an expert builder. Now others are building on it. So Paul is letting the church at Corinth know. He says, look, we're building a house. You are the temple of the living God. He says, I have laid the foundation like a master builder. Listen to what Paul says. He says, because of God's grace in verse 10, I have laid the foundation like an expert builder. Now others are building on it, but whoever is building on this foundation must be very careful, for no one can lay any other foundation other than the one we already have, which is in Jesus Christ. So the foundation is Jesus. Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He says, no one can lay any foundation other than the one we already have, Jesus Christ. Anyone, verse 12, who builds on that foundation may use a variety of materials. And he lists the materials. The materials are as follows. He says, gold. He says, I believe he starts from the most expensive to the least expensive. He says, gold, silver. He says, jewels. Then he gets down here to wood, hay. And then he says, straw. Reminds me of the story of the three little pigs. Three little pigs, one built the house out of straw, one built the house out of sticks, and one built the house out of brick. And we understand that the big bad wolf came and he would always say, little pig, let me in. And the little pig would say, not by the hair of my chinny chin chin. Or I'll huff and I'll puff and I'll blow your house down. I might have messed that up. I know Malachi, my son, he listens to these stories all the time. But we know that we are the Lord's temple, the Lord's house. Paul says that Jesus Christ is the foundation, and the question becomes, other people are building on you, other servants of God are building on you, and the Bible says some are using straw, some are using hay, some are using wood, some are using jewels, some are using silver, some are using gold, but at the end of the day, the Bible says in verse 13, but on the judgment day, fire will reveal what kind of work each builder has done. The fire will show if a person's work has any value. If the work survives, that builder will receive a reward. But if the work is burned up, the builder will suffer great loss. The builder will be saved, but like someone barely escaping through a wall of flames. So the Bible says that after the foundation is laid, the house is built. The preachers preach, you learn, the house is built. The house is built. Put a little door here, some windows. Now, Paul says, you have to be careful, number one, what types of material as a presenter of the good news of Jesus Christ, what type of material are you using as the builder? And then number two, you have to be careful when you are letting someone build on you, you need to know what type of material they are using. You don't want to have your house built out of straw. You don't want your house to be built out of hay. You don't want your house to be built out of particle board, which are pressed wood, which is wood chips glued together and made into a board. Because the Bible tells us that there is a enemy of our souls who's walking around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Now, the three little pigs had a big bad wolf. Help me, Holy Ghost. The three little pigs had a big bad wolf. We have the devil who is trying to not only get in our house, but he's also trying to destroy the house before the house can be completed. Listen to what the Bible says. In verse 16, don't you realize that all of you together, he's talking to the Corinthians, are the temple of God and the Spirit of God lives in you. God will destroy anyone who destroys this temple, for God's temple is holy and you are a holy temple. The Bible is telling us that God does not want his house to be built out of things that are not worthy of his house. In other words, the Bible says, build yourself up on things that are eternal. When you look in the Old Testament at the building of the temple, the place where the temple in the Old Testament was built was so sacred and so holy that they couldn't even use hammers to put the house together. They had to go down the side of the mountain and shape the stones that the house was built out of to format the house apart from where it was to sit, and then they had to come and put it together, and it had to be put together silently. God had restrictions and rules on how the house was to be built. Even in today's generation, you can't just build your house the way you want to build it. There are codes and there are code violations. You don't want a bootleg jack of all trade putting your roof on your house. Help me, Holy Ghost, Brother Thomas. Because what will happen is, if he does not follow the protocols and the procedures and the rules and the regulations, then that roof is going to leak. You don't want someone, a jackleg handyman, coming into your house and putting in your windows. Because if you do, there's a possibility that they won't be put in correctly. Now, let's go here to a few more scriptures here. If you will go with me in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 16 and verse 13, the Bible says in Matthew chapter 16 and verse 13, and this is Jesus speaking, and he's speaking about the foundation of the house. The Bible says, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do men say that the Son of Man is? Well, they replied, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, and others say Jeremiah or one of the prophets. Then he asked them, but who do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Jesus replied, you are blessed, Simon, son of John, because my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. You did not learn this from any human being. Now I say to you that you are Peter, which means rock. And upon this rock, I will build my church, and all the powers of hell will not conquer it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you forbid on earth will be forbidden in heaven, and whatever you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven. Then he sternly warned the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. the Bible tells us in the book of Isaiah, I believe, that Jesus not only is the foundation of the church, but he's also the cornerstone of the temple. And the Bible talks about he's also a stumbling block. But the Bible tells us to those who don't believe, the Bible tells us that upon the rock, which is Christ Jesus, you can see in Daniel chapter 2 that the Bible tells us that there is a rock that's cut out without man's hands that will destroy the kingdoms of the world. The Bible says that Jesus Christ is the rock of rock of our salvation. The Bible tells us that Jesus quotes and he says, if any man will listen to my words and follow them, I will liken him unto a man who digs down deep and builds down to the bedrock and builds his house upon a rock. And when the storms come and the winds blow, that house shall not be moved. But then he goes and he says, but anyone who builds their house without listening to my words will be building their house upon shifting sand. And when the storms come and the flood waters rise, the Bible says that the ruin of that house will be great. Jesus himself says that upon the rock that is Christ Jesus, the gates of hell will try to conquer it, but they will not prevail. Now, this is a scripture that has been taken out of context and used to promote all different types of misunderstandings, but that's a story for another day. Now, the question becomes, if God is saying that there are certain materials that should be used for the house of God, or that should be used to build up the house of God, which you are, to build the temple of God, the question that I would ask you is, how do you know what types of material to use to build the house? And how do you know when you have the correct material? When I go to Home Depot, my God, there's so many, it's just rows and rows and rows of material, okay? And that's good. Home Depot, Lowe's, Menards. You go in there, you can buy a toilet. I went down the toilet section. And you know what toilets are good for? To get rid of the waste byproducts. I'll go into Menards and I see all of these toilets. It's probably about 30 different types of toilets that you can buy, ranging from $100 up to $300, $400, $500. And I'm sitting there looking at all these toilets. And as I'm sitting there, a lady walks by and she looked me dead in the eyes. She said, I did not know that there were so many types of toilets. And I said, you're right. She said, how do I know which one to pick? And I said, well, I'm just going to get the cheap one. Until I talked to somebody who understood toilets. And the person who understood toilets told me, he said, if you buy the cheap toilet, you're going to have more problems and you're going to wish that you had spent a little extra money on a more expensive toilet. And I said, okay, so I'm just going to table purchasing the toilet until I figure out exactly what toilet I need. And the crazy thing about it is, oftentimes when you go to get stuff for your house, you automatically migrate to the cheaper option, when the cheaper option is actually going to stress you out later on down the line. My dad would always tell me, if you got the resources, get it done right the first time. Okay, is everybody with me? Yes, they are. Hello, Pew. All right, and so here it is. I was looking at the toilets and I was like, okay, there's the toilets. I went and I looked at the tubs and there's the tubs. Went and I looked at the drywall, four or five different types of drywall, four or five different types of everything. And I'm trying to figure out, how do I know? But then, I was invited to take a tour of a high-end home supply store. Let's put it that way. And I walked through this store and I saw toilets and bathtubs that ranged from probably $1,000 to $2,000 to $3,000 to $4,000. This was a high-end factory store that didn't sell the things that were in Home Depot. They sold things like the things that were in Home Depot, but they were much, much, much more expensive. There was a different quality to the material. There was a different quality to the fixtures. There was a different quality to the, let's just put it this way. I'm saying, and listen, there was an art gallery near the toilet room. Help me, Holy Ghost. This is the high-end side of things. I was like, oh my God. The point of the matter is, how do you know when you have a $100 toilet versus a $5,000 toilet? They both do the same thing. One just does it a little different. I'm glad you asked. I'm going to go here to Revelation chapter 3, because Jesus doesn't leave us without a metric to understand how to know when the person who's building on you is using inferior material. And this doesn't just work on houses. This also works on cars. It's one thing to buy a brand new transmission. It's another thing to utilize a used transmission. If it was up to me, I would purchase a new transmission than a used transmission based upon the type of car. I'm just telling you, you have to make sure that the person who's building on you, the person who's working on you, is using quality material. Because if they do not, you're going to have problems down the road when the fire comes. Help me, Holy Ghost. If you were to be building a bathroom and you did not put mold-rated drywall in the bathroom where moisture will be, you're going to run into problems down the road. If you were to put, I'm just saying, if you were to put laminate flooring in a basement that was not rated for moisture, you're going to run into problems. And so the Bible tells us that if you have people who are building on you with inferior material, there's going to come a day when that material is not going to stand up to what is happening inside the house. Yeah, the Bible says that one day down the chimney, a fire is going to come. And the fire is literally going to test what you're made of. It's called the refiner's fire. It's called the Holy Ghost. Jeremiah said it's something like this. It's like a fire shot up in your bones. And the Bible tells us that when the fire comes, it's going to burn up the straw. It's going to burn up the hay. It's going to burn up the wood. But when you get to higher end materials, some higher end materials are fire resistant. Help me, Holy Ghost. Yeah. Did you know that the only thing that will happen to gold when it's heated up is it becomes more pure? In other words, it becomes more golden. Do you know what happens to silver when it's heated up? It doesn't burn up. It becomes more silver. In other words, what takes place is it's refined. Literally, it shines brighter. Jewels don't burn up. Help me, Holy Ghost. They just twinkle in the fire. Is that all right with somebody? And so the Bible says that whatever you're made of is going to be tested because the fire is coming. But watch this. Listen to what the Bible says. Listen to what the Bible says. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 3 and verse 14, the Bible says, "And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things says the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God." These are the things that Jesus is saying. Listen what the Bible says. "I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth." Now, let me say this. I've had an issue. I'm just going to talk about my issue. There's something going on with my water spigot. What's happening is sometimes when I turn on the hot water, it doesn't let out hot water. It just lets out a trickle. And then sometimes I turn on the cold water and it just lets out all this cold water and the water is imbalanced. What the Bible is saying now is, the Bible is saying that the hot is on and the cold is on, and all you're getting is this lukewarm water. There was a time when my hot water heater didn't work. Help me, Holy Ghost. And I was just taking showers in ice cold. Ooh, you don't want to take showers in ice cold water. The point of the matter is, when the water isn't regulated correctly, it causes issues. And God is saying that there is an issue in this church. They're neither hot nor cold. They're a mixed temp water, and they are unprofitable. The Bible literally says that he does not like it when you are lukewarm. Listen to what the Bible says. He says, I would thou were cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Why are they cold? Why are they cold nor hot? The Bible says they say that they're rich and increase with goods, and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. The foundation was laid, but somebody had built upon their foundation utilizing materials, listen to me, utilizing materials that only looked high end. Help me, IKEA, come on down. Come on down, IKEA. The mattress at IKEA looks good till you lay on it. The furniture from IKEA looks good until you put it together with little screws and realize that it's pressed wood. Yeah, come on down. I'm trying to explain to you that they look high end. Help me, Holy Ghost. But they were really the base model. Yeah. Yeah, it looked like hardwood. Oh, my goodness. But it was particle board with a little laminate covering on the top, and you wouldn't know it was fake until it got wet. Okay. I'm just saying. And God is like, I've been to the high-end manufacturing plant, and I know what high-end materials look like, and you say that you have need of nothing, and I'm telling you that the minute the fire comes, this house is gonna burn down. Okay, listen to what the Bible says. He doesn't leave them there in verse 17. He says, because thou sayest, I'm rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. The Bible says in verse 18, he says, I counsel thee. What is God's preferred building material? Here it is. This is it. He says, I counsel thee that you buy from me gold. Listen to what he says. He says, I counsel thee to buy of me gold that's already been through the fire. Did you see it? You didn't see it. Paul paints the picture of laying a foundation in Christ, having builders build. He says, you have to be careful on, he said, the builders need to be careful that they're using the correct material. He says, you got to be careful that you're using the correct material, because the material that you use is going to be tried by fire. And whatever is not able to withstand the fire is going to burn away. But by God's grace, you can still be saved. That's what he says. Jesus, on the other hand, is saying, yeah, when I looked at your house, I discovered that you were wretched, you were miserable, you were poor, and you were blind, and you thought that your house was built out of things that could, that things that were eternal, but in reality, they were built out of things that were not eternal, but it was built out of things that weren't worth being built out of. And Jesus is saying, so what I'm suggesting that you do is that you come and get gold from me that's already been through the fire. And the reason you need gold from me that's already been through the fire is because when the fire returns, help me, Holy Ghost, the gold won't burn. Oh, you're not hearing me. Think about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They went through the fire, and they withstood the fire because they were standing next to someone who went through the fire with them. Okay, let's say it that way. Okay, I'm trying to explain. Jesus says, I need you to build your house out of things that have already been fireproof. Yeah, and the only way that you can build your house out of things that have already been fireproof if you go to someone who's already been through the fire. In this world, you will have trials and tribulations, but be of good cheer, because I've already gone through the fire. I've already gone through the flood. I was broken into pieces. Help me, Holy Ghost. And I came back. So I counsel you to buy from me something that's fireproof. Okay. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire. The process of fireproofing gold or refining gold is to heat it up until the impurities rise to the top. And you keep heating it up until all the impurities burn away. There was a silversmith, I heard the story, that the silversmith would heat the silver up, and he kept heating it up and kept heating it up. And his apprentice said, "Why do you keep heating up the silver?" And the silversmith said, "I'm heating it up. I'll know it's done when I start seeing my reflection in it." Help me, Holy Ghost. And so Jesus is simply saying, I got gold for you that's already been through the fire that I want to use to build you into something that's fireproof, that's able to house the fire of God when he comes in you. And in the last days, I'm going to pour my spirit out, and it's going to go into the house that's been fireproof. And now you're going to walk amongst the stones of God on fire. I'm done. You know, just because you get loud don't mean, being loud doesn't mean anything if your loudness doesn't point you back to the King. Who should I be listening to? You should be listening to someone who has gold tried by fire. And Jesus doesn't tell you to go to any man. He doesn't tell you to go to any woman. He doesn't tell you to go to any boy or any girl. But he does say, I counsel you to come to me because I got the gold, baby. I got the gold, and I'm going to give you the gold. And if you get the gold from me, you'll recognize when you got a licensed contractor working on you. How do you know you need a licensed contractor? Because the Bible tells us, this is a new verse, Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. And verse 14, well, verse 13 through 17. The Bible says in verse 13, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then, verse 14, can they call on him? This is Romans chapter 10, verse 14. How then can they call on him they have not believed in? And how can they believe without hearing about him? And how can they hear without a preacher? And how can they preach unless they are sent? And the person who is sent by God, like Apollos and Paul, these individuals aren't building with straw. These individuals aren't building with hay. These people aren't building with wood. These people aren't building with jewels. These people aren't even building with silver. They're building with gold tried by fire. They're building with kingdom money. Help me, Holy Ghost. And when you're building with kingdom money, you buy kingdom supplies. Help me, Holy Ghost. The Bible says, I will supply all your building materials. Help me, Holy Ghost, to build upon the foundation that is Christ Jesus. Okay, the Bible says, and how can they preach unless they are sent by the one who has the gold, sent by the one who's gone through the fire on your behalf. Listen to what the Bible says, but not how beautiful, verse 15, as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. And then it says, but not all obey the gospel. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our report? So faith comes from what is heard, and what is heard comes through the message about Christ. But I ask, did they not all hear? Yes, they did. The Bible says, in order for you to receive a builder who's building with gold, that individual has to be sent by Jesus Christ himself, the originator of fireproofed gold. And so how do you know when someone is building on you with the resources of heaven? Let me explain. The resources of heaven come from heaven, and this B-I-B-L-E is what gives you clarity when you're trying to determine who's building on you. This individual is not going to depart from the word of the living God in regards to the message that God has told him to proclaim. Paul said it, there is no other foundation other than that which is laid than what is laid in Christ Jesus. So don't come to me telling me that Jesus Christ is not the foundation. That's not biblical. All right, listen to what the Bible says in Revelation chapter 19, and I'm coming to an end. Let's talk about this fiery trial that this young man named Jesus Christ went through. The Bible says, and I saw in verse 11, I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. The Bible says his eyes were as a flame of fire. There was something on the inside of him that was lit up. And I'm here today to tell you that there's going to be something on the inside of you that is lit up. A fire in his eyes is symbolic of judgment. And I'm here today to tell you that when the Spirit of the living God comes and dwells inside of the temple of the living God in whom you are, when that fire comes in, that refiner's fire and empowers the vessels of God, when that house is built out of eternal material, gold that's already been fireproofed, not only will the Spirit of God dwell in that house, but the Spirit of God will cause light to shine forth from that house. And the Bible tells us then and only then can you now be a lighthouse in a world that's dark. Okay, did you not know that you are the light of the world? There can be no light if there isn't any fire on the inside. There cannot be any fire on the inside if the fire doesn't come down. The house cannot house the fire except it is built out of things that can withstand the fire. And that only comes from God. And he counsels you, come unto me, all you that are heavy laden. Not only will I give you rest, but I will begin to transform your dilapidated, depressed house that sits on the your abandoned house. I will not only fix it up, I'll turn you into an HGTV renovated property. Help me, Holy Ghost. And for you HGTV dwellers, viewers, the goal that you need is received from God. Listen to what the Bible says. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood. And his name is called the Word of God. And the armies were which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of God Almighty. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In order for this goal to be fireproof, God had to send his son. His name was Jesus. For God so loved this old wicked world that he gave his only begotten son to the world. The Bible says, and being found in the fashion of a man, Jesus humbled himself and became obedient even unto the death of the cross. He went to the cross. He went in the grave. He rose on Sunday so we could be saved. He didn't just rise, but he ascended into heaven, where he now intercedes on your behalf. And the Bible says that he has engraven you on his palms, that when he sees his palms, he understands what he went through to be able to give you the goal to build the house so the Spirit can come in and empower rather than destroy. He understands that he went through some things, and now he understands the difference between building materials that are not good versus building materials that are. And I'm here today to tell you that the key to receive this fireproof building material is the same key that Jesus used to unlock the prison doors of those who were in bondage, and that is one key word: obedience. Obedience. And being found in the fashion of a man, he humbled himself and became obedient even to the death of the cross. And here we are, being in the fashion of men, we find ourselves standing on the foundation, which is Christ Jesus. And as we obey the leading of God, then God himself will continue to improve on our house. It's a work in progress. I'm closing, Brother Thomas. I'm closing with a story. My cousin-in-law bought a house. And he took me on a tour of the house. We were leaving, and he said, "Joel, have you seen the house?" I said, "No." He said, "Let me take you on a tour of the house." He said, "Well, first and foremost, you see that wall there?" I said, "There's no wall there." He said, "Exactly, because I removed that wall." I said, "Really?" He said, "Yeah, all this was closed. I removed that wall. There was a door over there. I opened that up. I removed that." He said, "You see these steps? You see the carpet?" I said, "No, I don't see the carpet." He said, "I know, because I removed the carpet. I replaced the treads on the steps. I haven't stained them yet, but you can see the progress." He said, "Let's go on upstairs." He took me upstairs. He said, "Joel, this was just one big open space." He said, "You see that bathroom over there?" I said, "Yes." He said, "That bathroom is brand new. I put that in myself." He said, "You see the little office area over there?" I said, "Yes." He said, "I put that office area in." He said, "You see this nice paint?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Yeah, I did the painting. You see that?" He said, "Let's go on back downstairs to the basement." He said, "You see this area over here?" He said, "This used to be the garage. Now it's the mother-in-law's suite." He said, "Do you see all the drywall that I've done? And I just need to remove this gas line. I need to relocate it so that this whole area in the basement will be fixed." I said, "How many bedrooms does this house have?" He said, "It's a 4-bedroom house. When I bought it, it was a 2-bedroom apartment." I said, "Oh my God." He said, "Yes, I'm doing all the work myself from the inside out." He said, "But you wouldn't know what I've done if I didn't tell you about it. Help me, Holy Ghost." And I'm here today to tell you that my cousin-in-law, he bought the house not based on what it looked like then. He bought the house based upon what it could look like when he got done with it. Help me, Holy Ghost. I don't think the church is hearing me. He bought the house not based on what the house looked like then. He bought the house based upon what the house could look like later. And that's how Jesus is. Jesus tells us in Revelation 3, he said, "Behold, I stand at the door and I'm knocking on your house. And not only am I knocking on the house, but if any man will hear my voice and will open up the door, I'm going to move in with you, not based upon what you look like now, but based upon what you're going to look like when I get done with you." Do you see that wall of separation? Help me, Holy Ghost. That wall of separation between you and the Father? Of course you don't. Why? Because I removed the wall. Yeah, that's a word for the Christian today. Do you see this? Thank you, Jesus. I'm purchasing the house not based upon its current condition. I'm purchasing the house based upon my own ability and my own ability to provide everything that you need to become a fireproof dwelling place for the refiner's fire. Help me, Holy Ghost. So I'm going to remove that wall. I'm going to remove that old carpet. Whoa, I pull back that carpet. Wow, there's hardwood floors on here. Who covers hardwood floors? Help me, Holy Ghost. You see those old dirty cabinets? I got brand new cabinets for you. Gold cabinets. I'm replacing everything with gold. Yeah. When you get to the kingdom, guess what? Streets are paved with gold. I like gold. Gold, gold, gold. The point is, God is a restorer. God is a renovator. Sometimes on HGTV, you have individuals who purchase a house, not based on the house itself, but based on the foundation. And they call it, sometimes they call it the footprint. And do you know they purchase the house? And let me show you what they do. They tear the house down. They tear the whole house down. They tear everything down. All the way down to the foundation. That's what they do. Then they come in and using current modern technology, they put up some walls. Yeah. Instead of, and I'm telling you, these modern houses look like this. They put on the walls over there. Then they put you a little patio porch right here with some bars. Yeah. Then they give you a basement. And they turn you into a mansion. And that's what God has to do sometimes. Sometimes he has to tear it all the way down to the foundation. Because people have been using straw. And the big bad wolf came and huffed and puffed. They were using hay. And the big bad wolf came and huffed and puffed. They even used wood. And the big bad wolf came and huffed and puffed. They used jewels and the big bad wolf came and stole the jewels away. You had cast your pearls down before swine and they trampled them underfoot and then they turned and they rend you. But this gold here, God is saying, look, I'm going to get a backhoe and I'm going to get rid of all this. Throw it into the landfill of forgetfulness. And I want to start building on you with things that are eternal. Things that I know can withstand the fire. And the only thing that I know that can withstand the fire is the one who walks in fire. And if you're standing with him, if you're standing on him, you're standing in his word, standing on his word, and he's building you with gold, then no matter what comes your way, you will be able to withstand it because there's fire in you. It wasn't that Jesus was walking in the fiery furnace with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to save them. Mm-mm. It was the fact that there was fire in Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego that saved them. You're not hearing me. I'm done. I want to pray for you because you are answering the question, who should I be listening to you? Who should I be listening to? You should be listening to the one who has gold tried in the fire. And that's none other than Jesus Christ. And he doesn't mix his words. And whatever he says, tear down, tear down. Whatever he says, build up, build up. Why? Because he understands what you're going to go through. So it's better to listen to the one who's already gone through it. That's my word. I want to pray for you tonight. You can pray for you tonight that God would give you some of this gold tried in the fire. This is my prayer for you in Jesus' name. Let's pray. Father, give us the gold. Build us up on the foundation that you've laid, that is Christ. God, help us today. Help the words that we have heard to strike a nerve, that we would be our own seekers of truth, and that we would receive gold from you, and that we would listen to you as you build on us so that we can become dwelling places for the fire of God. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. God bless you and God keep you. Till we meet again on Saturday, amen. I will do anything just to see you, to behold you as my King. For your glory, I will do anything just to see you. To behold you as my King. Lord, if I find favor, come on, say, find favor in your sight. Lord, please, Lord, please, hear my heart's cry. I'm desperately.
Before him, say, wanna be where you are.
Gotta be where you are.
I wanna be where.
I wanna be where you are.
Gotta be where.